Hi everyone, thank you so much for coming. I'm going to try to direct us around in a circle here, but it's not going to be that easy. But my name is Kerry Skarbicka, and I'm an assistant professor of photography here at Sunny Oregon State University. And also the chair of the Visiting Artist and Scholars Lecture Series here. Now, show of hands, please. Somebody has, this is the first time to be to a VAS lecture. Show of hands. Oh, all right, great. Well, welcome. For those of you, this is the first time. This is called the VAS, for those of you who don't know. This has actually been our successful program over the years of bringing in distinguished artists and scholars into Oregon State campus. And we've had some wonderful artists over the years. We've had Anne Hamilton, which you might know, Bill Viola, Marina Bromvik, Hassan Alahi, Hankulis Thomas, who's recently with us, as was Dred Scott. Farrah Karapetian was here as well, and most recently, you might remember Rhea Anderson's lecture down at LaSalle Stewart. And all of these people have graced the presence in our various stages here at Oregon State. This is actually our first one doing with VAS in this particular building. I hope you like it, or in this room, I should say. I also want to reach out, a big thanks always to Leanne Garrison, our fearless leader, our Director of School of Arts and Communications. Without this program, without her, there would be no program. Without you, there would be no program. And without my lovely staff and colleagues that I love working with on a daily basis, without you, there would be no VAS. So thank you so much for the work that you do. I really appreciate it. Now, tonight's lecture actually marks the end to an outstanding year. And I'm actually honored to add, obviously, to the top of the cake here with this evening's guest, Mary McGonigal. Now, a little background why Marion is here with us. It's actually was fate, if you will. She was simultaneously nominated by both Professor of Art History, Kirsi Peltomäki, and one of our highly ambitious former undergraduates, Maddie Corbin, for some of you who might know her, who met Ms. Ghani during a New York Arts Practicum residency a year or so back. Upon returning from her residency, Maddie's enthusiasm for her interaction with Marion was undeniable. And from my own perspective, having been introduced to Marion's work through the Creative Capital Foundation, we all knew that it was just a matter of time before we were able to bring her here. Now, a little bit about Mary. She's an artist, a writer, a filmmaker. She received her BA in summa cum laude with honors in comparative literature from New York University in 2000, and an MFA summa cum laude in photography, video, and related media from the School of Visual Arts in 2002. Her work looks at places, spaces, and movements where social, political, and cultural structures take on visible forms and spans video, sound, installation, photography, performance, text, and data. She has exhibited and screened at the Guggenheim, the MoMA, Met Brewer, and the Queens Museum of New York, the National Gallery in Washington, D.C., the St. Louis Art Museum, the Indianapolis Art Museum, and Document 13 in Kabul and Kassel, among many others. Some of her recent texts have been published in Eflux, Freeze, Foreign Policy, and Triple Canopy. She is a 2015 Creative Capital grantee, and she has also received a number of fellowship and awards and residencies from Art Matters, the 18th Street Center in Los Angeles, the Shell Center for International Human Rights at Yale Law, and the Center for Constitutional Rights. ArtSpace notes that Ghani's work moves nimbly between the diverse and heady subjects and demonstrates the power of art to make sense of the mess that is contemporary geopolitics. The Village Voice notes that Ghani draws our attention to these other Americas, the unnoticed survivors of displacement, diaspora, and war. HECTV in St. Louis writes that Marion Ghani encourages her viewers to reflect upon challenging issues through seductive imagery, poetic language, and multiple layers of meaning that unfold over time. And finally, from the New York Times, if she sounds like a philosopher, poet, well, she is. But she is also a feminist, an artist, an archivist, and an activist. It's my honor and pleasure to present Mary McGonigal.
Okay, can you all hear me? How's the volume on that? It feels very loud to me, but it sounds okay to you? Okay, great. All right, so thank you, Kerry, for that introduction, and thanks to all of you for bringing me here. And bear with me as I understand the dynamics of this circular room and walk around to see you all. I'm going to get so dizzy by the time this is over. Okay, since our time is limited and time is here demands a lot of it, what I'm going to do is give you an overview of my practice, included excerpts from films, and if you want to watch all of the film later, I can send Terry or your department a list of viewing links wherein you can see the full-length film. So just holler about that later. So as Terry said, my practice is based on research into places, spaces, and moments where social, political, and cultural structures take on invisible and tangible forms. A good example of this is this children's playground, which is constructed from parts discarded by North Sea oil rigs in Norway. This is like politics in invisible form. Another example is this migrant labor camp in the undeveloped desert outside Sharjah in the United Arab Emirates. So I'm interested in understanding both how we reconstruct the past in the present, and how we construct the present for the future through shifting private and public narratives. And sometimes this research leads me to construct a fiction or reconstruct a speculative history, which is sort of the theme of this talk, around documents or fragments, physical traces, or a sense of place, as in much of my work with the choreographer Erin Ellen Kelly, one of the long-term collaborators, and composer Kasim Nakhvi, another one, on the series that we call Performed Places. And that includes this project, The City in the City, which is loosely adapted from the sci-fi noir novel by China Mayville of the same name. And it was shot in St. Louis just months after the death of Michael Brown during a series of protests that would come to be known as Ferguson October, which became a key crucible for the Black Lives Matter movement. So here is an excerpt.
The construction site had been abandoned at least 5 years before, judging from the tree that grew on the mound of excavated dirt. I was lying in the dirt, where I had been abandoned, like whatever property had once been planted here. Nothing is still like the bed stairs. The wind moves the air as it moves mine, and then I'm just fine at all. My body was in an ugly pose, with legs crooked as if about to get up. My face was set in a startled strain, endlessly surprised by myself. My normal expression shattered like glass. It was impossible to say, looking at this shell, what I looked like, what face those who knew me would see if they heard my name. The detective looked at me and saw a series of jagged tears and splits, a disassembled body. I looked unseemly up at her, up at myself, blank as any mirror tilting in the wrong direction. This detective was not a police woman. She was too unofficial for that, though the fact that she was permitted on the site meant she probably had been official once. She had some other purpose here. She represented some other interest. We were out of the way, but I could feel a tension on us like insects. Women and men leaning from windows in apartment buildings and haphazardly parked cars to inspect the rites of disaster. There were other buildings around as well, and other men, and other women, of course, who were carefully not watching us, who were carefully not noticing my body, stripped in death of his identifying marker, of anything that made it safe to see, to know. Do you know anything about my city? Like most cities, it believes itself to be its own country, with its own laws and borders and customs, but unlike, perhaps, your city, it has made that belief into reality. Like many cities that appear to be one city or one country, it's actually two. Some cities are divided by a river or a train track. Some cities are zoned green and red with concrete barricades marking the difference. Some cities have borders that constantly shift, following the whims of capital. Some cities, like my city, are cross-hatched. Some places totally ours, and others belonging wholly to them. Places where spurs of one city jut unexpectedly into the other. Places where the cities are so densely interwoven that you can step from one to the other by crossing a single square of paper. And the descent, the space is claimed by both a new city, which exists in a kind of limbo between them. My city and its other had, in the past century, formalized a non-relation, ignoring the territorial integrity in favor of political separation. To pass officially from here to there, you had to cross the bridge to nowhere, a span with an unusual kink. That crossing brought you back, spatially, to the same place you had started from. But having passed over the border to another country, all the luxury high-rises, the corporate towers, the tree-shaded mansions that flickered uneasily in peripheral vision in our city could not be looked at directly. There were other ways to cross the border, by which I mean crossing without being found out by the police. Some crossings were passed down as family secrets, like the network of underground tunnels connected to Brewer's Cave, which legends held had been used by slaves escaping north centuries before. Other crossings were discovered by the unificationists who explored the cities looking for spots where the cross-hatching between the cities was so intricate and subtle you could cross from city to city while standing still with eyes closed, not looking at anything you were not supposed to see, merely thinking yourself from here to there. As children, of course, we played with the boundary in precisely the same way, testing how far we could go without violating the limits we were still learning. Everyone on both sides of the border knows the whole folktale of the boy and the girl who fell in love as children, spotting each other across the street one day, only to realize they're not quite the same street that they walked on, and how they grew up and eventually old together, walking side by side through life, never touching or even directly acknowledging each other's existence, perfectly aware of their perfect and impossible love. Everyone plays some variant of this game at some point, trying to mirror the movements of the other counterpart without quite looking at each other. Perhaps you went further than I did. Perhaps you threw something across a spur there and picked it up when it landed again here, thrilled by the faintly illicit contact. Perhaps you've been through that bit of rock or wood casually into the path of your not quite acknowledged playmate over there, and didn't watch as she threw it back also casually over here, picking it up with exaggerated surprise when it skipped in front of your feet, half expecting all the while that grief would arrive with an unknown power to take you away to unimaginable doom. They never did, of course. Children are given some time to learn the rules. The leaves must come from somewhere when they blow, wrote one of your poets. But in our city, we learned early to kick our way with pleasure through the drifts of fallen autumn leaves on treeless streets, and not to think too hard about where they could possibly have blown in from. Gradually, so gradually we almost didn't notice how it was taught, we learned to unsee everything and everyone up over there, and only see what was ours, here. They and there were present, of course, in the same physical space, but we acquired the habit of evaluating in a glance where someone belonged by the walk, clothes, way of holding themselves, and looking away from what was not like us, so reflexively that we only ever saw venomous flashes in the corners of our eyes, turned hastily toward the ground and sky. Even their voices became muted, random noise. We wove around them, unseen and unhuman, and we knew that they did the same to us. Politeness, I believe, was the way they learned it. It's better not to exchange gazes with those less fortunate than you, because it will only remind those lacking of their lack and make those who possess feel guilty about their possessions. Where only the dead and reach may go is another saying in our city, and that meant, I suppose, that I could not cross at will between here and there, could see everything now, that I could tell nothing, small comfort and no recognition.
Okay, so that's a little bit of the city in our city. And what the city in the city does is that rather than directly documenting the moment in which it's made, it basically wraps a kind of speculative fictional framework around real St. Louis places and their very specific histories. For example, this is Kinlock, which is the oldest incorporated black settlement in Missouri, and which, as you can see, was really devastated by a plan in the 1960s to expand the St. Louis airport, which then never happened. Because we bought up a whole bunch of lots, it demolished half of them, and then it abandoned the plan, and this is what Kinlock looks like now. And that is the that is the next township over from Ferguson. So, you know, what happened in Ferguson comes from a very deep set of structural inequities famously failed housing, public housing project in St. Louis, which has had many chapters to its history at the time that I made this film. In 2015, this is what Fruit Igo looked like. It was a forest in the middle of the city, because the entire lot after this giant public housing project was demolished had been bought up by a single developer, who then also proceeded to buy up all of the lots that became empty around it, as that destruction kind of rippled outward through the surrounding neighborhoods and then was compounded by the construction of a freeway through the middle of North St. Louis, which was mostly black. The same developer hung on to these lots for decades until the NGA, the National Geospatial Agency, decided that it would build its new campus right here, right where Pruitt Igoe used to be. If you don't know what the NGA is, it is the our government's spy satellite agency. So that's what's happening in Pruitt Igoe now. That forest has been bulldozed, and they're building the spy satellite agency's new home there. So everything in St. Louis always has these multiple layers wrapped around it, and that's why, in a way, this fictional framework was one of the easiest ways to address it, because if you try to just look at it through documentary, you can never penetrate enough layers of the onion that is St. Louis. There is an incredibly tight weave in American cities like St. Louis and also Baltimore, where I grew up, between spatial and racial politics, and that is essentially what this film is about. This is the other part of this project.
Thank you.
One of the really fun things about like whatever was started is the score, of course, which is entirely choral, but it's based on ambient sound that we recorded during filming, so it's just voices making all the sounds you hear, including what sounds like wind, or what sounds like birds, kind of like it's all done through whistling, or like people like snapping against their cheeks, or kind of like different fun little effects like that. Let's see if I can get this back. There we go. More? No? Okay, there we are. Had to be one of them. Okay, so in this piece, To Live, this is based on a drawing room war novel, a modernist novel by the poet H.B. Hilda Doolittle. Which is called Bid Me to Live. Bid Me to Live is about World War I in London, but it's a drawing room war novel because it takes place at a distance from the actual war. And it's all about what happens to people who are waiting for the war to be over. And it's kind of a spiraling stream of consciousness novel from a narrator who's made unreliable by the strain of an apparently endless war and the trauma that she tries desperately not to remember. And this kind of provided a narrative framework for improvisations that we did in former military housing on Governor's Island, for which I also time-shifted the text a little bit to World War II instead of World War I. It was a more interesting period in the history of Governor's Island. There were a lot of different kinds of prisoners being held there at the time, including conscientious objectors, Italian POWs. There's a lot of different kind of strange things happening on the island. In that moment, and if you don't know anything about Governor's Island, it is a small island in the East River of New York, which is half artificial, but the artificial part was constructed in the 1870s from the infill, which was basically the extra dirt that was excavated during the construction of the 456 subway line. And that part of the island is totally flat, and the rest of it has a natural hill, so you can really tell that half of it is artificial. It's like super obvious. And it was a military installation from the 1770s until the 1960s. So for a very, very, very long time. That's kind of what we
went. There was a path you had to walk. There was a rank for every house, for every room. Everything named, and the names made an order, and the order made a space. And there she was in her place, placed in her room. Chief in importance, the room itself, the frame to the picture, the shutters closed tight against the possibility of carnage. I myself, this is my room. What had happened the year before that, was hardly more than a reflection of a rim of a glass set down on a varnished table, a rain a year last year. Atmosphere was already dimmed into vague reflections of memories, a cottage loaned by a friend, and cooking meals on a camp stove, holding out against something that was later to be more completely shattered, as against something to be too early shattered. They were moved rather than moving, hedged in by comment, by precise and precisely aimed poisonous arrows, by words that meant nothing but that stung all across the surface of life. Ambushed, they dodged. It was a black arrangement. They might have made a success of their experiment. They both wanted to be free. They both wanted to escape. They both wanted a place where they could browse over their books. They had friends in common. They had common names. Americans in London, superficially entrenched. They were routed out by the sound of aircraft. She stumbled down the iron stairs of the Hampstead flat and bruised her knee, just in time to see the tip-tilted object in a dim near sky that even then was sliding sideways and even then was about to drop. Leviathan, whale swam in city dusk, above suburban forest. It was a black flash. She might have broken her leg. As he filled a basin from the bathroom, her mind, which did not really think and canalize precise images, realized, or might have realized, that if she had had the child in her arms at that moment, stumbling as she had stumbled, she might have. No, she did not think this. She had lost the child only a short time before, but she never thought of that. The door had shuttered it in, shuttering her in. Something had died that was going to die. Or because something had died, something would die. But she did not think that. And he lifted the slightly tainted bowl of water and said, "Poor Julia, poor Judy." And it didn't matter that the papers couldn't pay them for translations any longer. And Ray said he might as well on the list is give up this time and check statistics. Why not, he said. Might as well, he said. And she did not shout, how could she? Oh God, enlist then, go, 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 go. But still he went, and she was dragged along with him, bumping over the steps and over the ocean, a creaking trunk wrapped up in twine. Protest stopped up in her mouth. It was shut in her as other things were shut in her because the war will be over. The war will never be over. After he enlisted, she found a room near the castle. But then he had not yet gone, and this was after the child, and they were just where they had been except for a gap in her consciousness. A sort of black hollow, a cave, a pit of blackness, a black nebula not yet concentrated out into clear thought. The surface was as the surface had been, only colder. Shivering, she received the dregs of what had been, not openly resentful. You will always regret it if you do not have this child. And then September, in the muse, the shock and the fall in the darkness. You're susceptible to shock, a face swimming in white. You should not have another child until the war is over. If the wind had been nearer the surface, she could have grappled with it. It was annihilation itself that gaped at her. I'm sorry, as if I could possibly mean anything. Did I hurt you, Judy? Such a fear is not easily dealt with. Perhaps better, no knowledge. This was no occasion for a little knowledge as a dangerous thing. The greater the gap in consciousness, the more black hole of Calcutta the cap, the more informed with that nebula of her reasoning, the more glorious would be the opening up into clear, defined space, or the more brilliant a star chaser would emerge, if somehow, at some time, the surface could be adequately dealt with. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. This is not that day. But the more she feared, repudiated Rafe in her black hole self, the more she strove to reach him. This is our flat, this is our room, this is our bed. I mustn't get nervous, it would spoil everything, was, if any, the thought that sustained her.
So that's a little bit of To Live, which uses repetitive images to signal the way that the mind kind of spirals around the trauma, getting closer and closer to it, but always circling, never quite directly looking at it. When thinking about speculative history, the method is sort of akin to the way that speculative fiction starts with something that you can observe in the present and speculates forward from that, and speculative history likewise starts with something you can observe in the present and speculates backwards. And in this case, when we had this residency on Governor's Island through the Lower Manhattan Cultural Council and spent time in these houses, they were permeated with this air of waiting, just of women waiting. And that was the feeling that was in them for us. And when I then read about this book, I was doing research on conscientious objectors in Governor's Island. Robert Lowell, the poet, was one of them. It's one of the conscientious objectors held in Castle William on Governor's Island. And I was reading about Robert Lowell, and in a book on Robert Lowell, someone mentioned Bid Me to Live as being the ultimate drawing room war novel. And I was like, that's what we need for these houses. That's what needs to happen in these houses. That's what will bring out what was there. And so that's how that came about. Over the years of this collaboration with Erin and Kasim, we've worked in a number of different modes and scales, from a hastily assembled afternoon shoot in a gutted McDonald's on 57th Street, which became the video Three Surrenders, and this kind of pairs visuals of Erin's improvised dance in the space with my own improvised and later vocal performance in the sound. And then a two-week road trip in which the two of us conceived, scouted, costume, and shot landscape studies in Mexico, which is a meditation on the days in Mexico has been used and imagined by all those who come to it as strangers, from conquistadors and cowboys to participant ethnographers and missile testers. So we can look at a little bit of that.
Thank you.
Just a little taste of the Gabriel Mexico. Just divided into sections, basically organized by color, and that's because in the sort of belief system of Kewa people who lived in the Galisteo Valley, which is where we shot most of the studies in Mexico, every direction has a color. So each section of landscape studies in Mexico is associated with the direction of the colors of north, south, west, east, above, and below. So you just saw the below section, basically, which is black, which makes sense. One of the things that happened with this project, which is unlike the way I usually work, is that we shot it and then researched it later. In fact, we spent 2 years finishing the project because we shot it first and then researched it later. So it actually takes longer than researching it first and shooting it afterwards. And this turned out to be a really crucial project for the development of our collaborative research process. This was done in 2008-2010, fairly early on in our collaboration. And while we were looking into the various disciplines invented in New Mexico, of which there actually are a lot, it's like the birthplace of American anthropology and archaeology, and ethnography was invented there. Landscape studies was invented there, which is why it's called landscape studies. Landscape archaeology is also very much associated with New Mexico, and we got interested in that, and we adopted a method from landscape archaeology for looking at place, which is to examine each place along three axes, the first being the historical uses of a place, the second being the contemporary understanding of a place, and the third being the phenomenological experience of a place, which is basically what is it like to be a body in that place. So in our work, basically from this work forward, but actually going backwards as well, there's always something in each work that represents each of those three things. So the performing body obviously is a phenomenological experience, kind of measuring the space for you, the viewer, but there's also elements of the costume and sometimes references in the score, and also ways that we think about the scenography that are looking at the historical uses, referencing historical uses. And then, of course, the way that I frame things can also have historical references, as in like water from stone, but very often it speaks a contemporary understanding of the place, which also is very much informing the overall structure of a piece. So in like water from stone, for example, the overall structure is actually geological. It starts with a place that was formed, the rocks in the beginning of like water from stone were formed in the Ice Age, and then it goes to a cave that was inhabited in the Stone Age, and then it kind of progresses forward from there. And here we have something informed structurally by belief system of the people who were native escaped by conquest, which I think is a sort of crucial thing to New Mexico, thinking about New Mexico. In a way, this was also my first film about film, because you can't make a film about landscapes in New Mexico without running across all the other ways those landscapes have been depicted and deployed, including by other filmmakers. And even that just that little section you saw, like that was in The Man Who Fell to Earth, because a lot of New Mexico was in The Man Who Fell to Earth. And also, like most landscapes that interest me, it's marked by war. So this is a list of publicly known missiles that were tested at White Sands in New Mexico. Of course, there are others that we don't know about. So these are the classified ones. And this is what White Sands looks like, because 3 days of the week it's open to the public as a park, and 2 days of the week they still test missiles there. So we've worked alone as in those examples, staging a series of performances that are equally specific to the medium in which they're made, to the medium of video and to the stage where they're made, and which then need to use larger formal and conceptual structures. And we work with very small groups of performers, and in our first collaboration, Future for Frames, which was shot in Germany, Rococo era Schloss Solitude and the Solitude Rococo Park Forest, and looked for the kind of traces of human intervention in this massive Rococo era planned landscape that had been allowed to revert back into its natural state. So it's basically like a forest where every single view from the path is perfect, and at first you don't notice how unnatural that is, but when you start thinking about it, you're like, oh, this isn't actually a forest, it's like a giant garden. That turned into a forest over hundreds of years. We also, at one point, made a choreographed documentary called Smile, You're in Sharjah, which is a kind of a riff on city symphony films of the early 20th century. But it's a city choreography instead of a city symphony, where much of the dance is constructed in the editing, but some scenes were actually staged with the participation of ordinary citizens of Sharjah, who consented to have their everyday movements slightly rearranged or heightened for the camera. And it's important to note that many of these people were migrant workers, because they are the people who are most often found in the public spaces of the city, which we were interested in looking at. So just between the sea and an existing position between the sea and the desert. One of the sort of themes of the film are these kind of cycles of consumption and commuting and construction and destruction and reconstruction that fuel it, also migration. One of our little things in the film is that we follow all the water in the city. There's actually a massive desalination plant run by the authorities of Sharjah, which then delivers those bottles, those oasis bottles all over the city. You kind of see the bottle all throughout the film, and eventually we do get to the desalination plant itself. It's a little like running thread to the film. Of course, Aaron and Cosmo were also involved in creating a brief history of classes, which was my 2-channel installation for the 2012 Documenta, which some of us talked about yesterday, and exploit the uncanny similarity between two buildings constructed 2 continents and 2 centuries apart, which are the Museum of Cristiano in the castle and the Dalai Palace in Kabul. To send 2 cameras on parallel journeys to the interiors, chasing 2 figures who constantly need either the frame of the screen or the frame of the architecture.
The Brothers family began this story with "there was once," and perhaps even added, "and there will be again." Arabic folk jazz began with the phrase "kan ya makan," "there was or there was not," implying that the story that follows may or may not have this whole, or at all, or as yet. In either case, there rests a suggestion that time is not a purely linear construct, but rather something that bends around the events of the tale, or the storyteller's will, which is to say that the past and future both inhabit the present, and history can be imagined not simply as a relentless forward march, but also as a hall of mirrors, a spiral maze, a path switchbacking up a mountain, a door that swings back and forth on its hinges, or a dog endlessly chasing its own tail. In France, some folk tales begin with the formulation "assez seasoning," which means that the story you're about to hear might be 1 of 7 or 30. You could hear about the same events. If you wander like a lost anthropologist around the countryside, asking the same question in different houses. You could also interpret this beginning to mean that every story, examined closely, is made up of other stories, which depend on other stories, which lead into other stories, and so on, branching and twisting into infinity. So, the story, or stories, you're about to hear, may or may not be true. They may have happened long ago and far away, or quite close to where you stand today, within the reach of present memories, or before the precisions of recorded histories. In these stories, books, among other things, are burned, and banned, and stolen, and sought. So it is useless to pretend, while telling these stories, that words have no greater consequences, or that myth never becomes history, or history myth. Equally, it is useless to pretend that stories are told without intent. Every storyteller is Shakrazada, fighting to preserve either herself or the existence of something she values. So, there was once, or perhaps there wasn't, a palace. The palace was a parliament, or a museum, a library, or a refuge, a ministry, or a battleground. We can agree, at least, that it was and is a building, or rather 2 buildings, constructed 2 centuries apart. We may imagine that one building echoes the other. We may be certain that each building contains its own echoes, the ghosts of what did or did not happen within its halls. These 2 buildings also share a curious condition. For those who know it best, the building exists in a state of suspension between what it was, what it is, and what it could be. Perhaps this is true of every building. Perhaps every building is a stone in the stream of history, around which it is possible to see the waters fall. Every building, then, is both object and process, and must be examined as such. A physical fact that is constructed and reconstructed by circumstance. In the case of the museum,
So then it sort of, the brief history passes goes on to look at history from the perspective of these 2 buildings, but that sort of the beginning kind of expresses some of my philosophy about storytelling, and it is a story about storytelling because I sort of took this opportunity to tell a story about storytelling because the Brothers Grimm were actually librarians in the Friedrichstein building at the time that they collected all of the fairy tales for the Grimm. Famous for kind of collections of fairy tales. And they had like very specific reasons for doing that, also because they were involved in a lot of German nationalist movements, and it was part of their consolidation of German identity. There's a lot of politics in fairy tales if you didn't know that yet. Okay, so as you said, this film is all tracking shots, which is a nightmare, and the camera's movements in the buildings, the speed of the shots, and the placement of the cut will have to be very carefully mapped out, using architectural diagrams of buildings, and those can be found, drawing them myself, and at the same time, voiceover narration used back and forth between the histories and myths surrounding the two buildings, which is the actual and potential selves of the buildings. To distill 2 years of research into a 22-minute voiceover and to write these two histories in a non-linear way that avoided drawing easy parallels between buildings and cities and instead made more unexpected connections, I made this research map and used its idea trails to write the text. When people ask, what does it mean to have a research-based practice? I just show them this drawing. this is what it means. And it's crazy. It's pretty fun. It's kind of fun. As you have seen already, like some of my recurring preoccupations are border zones, no man's lands, translations, transitions, the slippages where cultures intersect, security cultures, archives, architectures of democracy, national imaginaries, places where nature and artifice imitate and influence each other, and the intersections of war, trauma, memory, identity, migration, language, and loss. Carrie mentioned I sometimes work with data, and this was a project about language loss and data, which is the Garden of Forked Tongues. It's a data visualization of endangered languages that are spoken in the borough of Queens. It's an example, basically, of my database form approach to research in general, which is basically accumulating a collection of materials and then developing several different interfaces to them. So in this case, the first one was this giant wall painting, which is 44 feet by 100 feet, and painted in acrylic gouache with vinyl letters used to make these cutouts, which are the word for tongue in each of these languages. And each polygon represents a language that is slowly or rapidly disappearing from the world but spoken in this one borough of New York City. I also wrote an essay, and in collaboration with my very brilliant graduate student, I created an online version of the project as well, which is still online, ryanbatty.com/forktongues, you can put it there. Afghanistan Lexicon, and I've been printful photos, another example of this. It functions as part of the Documenta 13 notebook series, as a standalone book, a companion piece to Reconstruct Collapses, and a smaller set of prints that play with the look and form of colonial era encyclopedias. In general, a Afghanistan lexicon uses the inherently open and variable form of a lexicon to attempt a different kind of history writing, again, thinking about speculative history, where it's not linear, causative, or progressive, but circular and cross-reference, tracing both individual narratives and larger systems or structures that enclose them through an emphasis on spatial politics and spatial poetics. I'm just going to wrap up by saying a last little bit about speculative histories, because this is how I work, which is with public histories, private narratives, and the gaps between them. And when I speculate as to what may fill those gaps, I do so because the histories that have always interested me the most are the ones that usually remain unwritten, the marginalized, the repressed, unofficial, and assumed to be unimportant. Speculative history may seem like a slightly scary notion in this time of fake news and alternative facts, but when all that remains of certain histories is the dangling threads, the frayed edges where official accounts break off and become inadequate, the spaces between the lines of histories that were written by the victors, in which the defeated must read for the shadows of their lives, and the outlines of all that has been removed, redacted, erased, and disappeared, that's when we must become speculative historians. Thank you.
Film or any other art forms so powerful.
question. I think in the interviews that I've done for What We Left Unfinished, looking at this kind of time in the communist period when in Afghanistan, and I think in a lot of other places that went through similar histories, there was a belief in the power of art, and especially in film, as a weapon. What people have talked about is the way in which, in their particular mind, there were a couple of different things that their films did. And one was they served to record history. They were records of the moment, and they were, in a way, also like promises for the future, because in many ways what they were doing was imagining an Afghanistan that didn't really exist yet, but that they wished existed. And so film does provide a space, especially fiction films do provide a space in which you can try to will a better world into existence. You can depict the world as you want it to be rather than as it is. And sometimes that has a lot of power. For example, when people look at these images of Afghanistan from that period, they're always shocked at what women are wearing, that people are drinking, that people are throwing house parties, that like people are dancing, that there's a whole different kind of way of life being undertaken in these images. And I always say, don't be too deceived by that, because that may have been happening, but only in like the tiniest sliver of society. And only in the cities that were controlled by the regimes, and only for a kind of brief period of time. But does that make it any less revolutionary that it exists on film? Does that make it any less of a potential, weapon for remaking Afghanistan at some future time? I think it's still kind of pretty incredible, and could be pretty revolutionary still, that these things exist and can be dispersed and can say, look, this other Afghanistan was imagined once, it could exist again, right? So I think that's one of the ways in which film can be a weapon. Another is like in the classic sense of propaganda, and these were filmmakers who also did make propaganda, which is just to like really bluntly communicate ideas of the state, like ideas of the government to the people. And they were very much engaged in that, and they believed very strongly that like art should be useful. Like, they were really invested in that idea, and they're still invested in it, and they hate that art isn't useful right now. They really hate that. Like, why isn't the government making use of us? Like, why isn't that happening? Because we could bind this nation together, if they just used us to do it. And I think the other thing that they talk about is the way in which they were trying to provide through art and culture a space in which a kind of secular alternative could be created, a kind of different way of being, a different kind of culture. And this was a time when like the divisions that we're really seeing proliferate throughout the world now, these divisions between fundamentalism and secularism were really just beginning to be as profound as they are now. And they have recurred and recurred in the time since these films were made, and just gotten deeper and deeper, especially in Afghan society. And I think to think about the way in which, as one of the actors I interviewed, Yasmin Yarmal, said, if the government doesn't pay any attention to art and culture, we'll just be left with the same Taliban and Daesh all over again, because there is no other message being put out. There's no alternative being offered. There's no other kind of like culture that's ours, that's not of the West, that's ours, but like it's not fundamentalist, that's being kind of put out as an alternative into our society. So, that's another thing that they were trying to do. They were trying to create, as the last communist government called it, the Islamic Communist Republic of Afghanistan, which is a little bit of an oxymoron, but they were trying to reconcile those values together. Yeah. Does anyone else have a question? Oh, back here? Yeah.
I noticed a theme of, for lack of a better term, embodiment in your work. There's a lot of the human body and interacting in different ways, unexpected ways. And you also mentioned, you know, you like to work with space, moments, in between places. I was wondering if you could talk more about kind of that aspect of it, the human body and embodiment as a concept.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's because a lot of my work is about things that aren't there. Like, I don't know who I was talking about this with, maybe Julia the other day, but someone once told me I was the artist who was known for making work about things that weren't there. And I was like, I'll take it. That's a good thing to be known for. That's kind of a nice description. But I think because I am so interested in, you know, unwritten histories, in disappearances, and absences, and reductions, and erasures, I think the presence of the body is a way to push back against that, as a way to sort of think about how to recover some of what has been lost. And I think, you know, when we are dealing with these really difficult and contested and often, like, you know, really fragile histories and things that only exist as the tiniest traces, sometimes the only way to recover them is through the body. And materializing things helps a lot when you're dealing with things that have disappeared. It's one of the reasons we actually have a physical archive for a mix of this here. We actually have thousands of pages of documents that live in my apartment in binders. It isn't just an artistic gesture to materialize these things that mostly exist as PDFs on the internet. It actually turned out that some things became reclassified after we printed them out. Like, years later, they would be declassified, we printed them out, and then, like, 5 years later, someone reclassified them. So, like, there's sometimes also a utility to materializing things. Material is always subject to disappearance. Anyone else?
Thanks. So in regards to the theme of speculative histories and delving into unwritten and untold stories, what is your starting process and what makes you decide that something's worth rediscovering? And also, at what point in your, you know, investigations do you feel like something's been studied enough that it justifies an exhibit? Or in simpler terms, what's your process of study?
Right, yes. So in terms of how I select things to make work about, well, I have the one very long-term ongoing project, which is Index of the Disappeared, which has now been running for 14 years. And then What We Left Unfinished has similarly been going on for 5 years. But in terms of the projects I do with Aaron and Kasim, those are time limited. They actually usually end within 2 years, which is shorter. And sometimes we finish them within 6 months, but usually only if we have a deadline and a specific funder giving us money and a deadline. I think, you know, what will draw us to, like, a specific place, for example, usually has to do with those features of the landscape that I mentioned earlier. If it's a place where, you know, there's some kind of blurry boundary between an artificial and natural landscape, like there's a constructed landscape that looks like a natural landscape or a natural landscape that looks like a constructed landscape, that's always something that really attracts us. also places where you can kind of see politics materialize in some way, also places where you can see the traces of a war manifested in some kind of visible, tangible way. Those are all things that will make me want to kind of look at a place. Like Sharjah was very interesting because, you know, the it's one of the few places in the Gulf where migrants are really visible, even though migrant labor underpins the entire economy of the Gulf region. Sharjah is one of the only places where migrants are actually really allowed to hang out in public spaces. And in fact, they like hang out in all the median strips. Like, they use the median strips as parks, because they're not allowed in some of the bigger, more official parks. But so it makes them super visible all over Sharjah. They're everywhere, all the time, because they also work 24-hour, like, they're 24-hour construction shifts, and they're always migrant laborers everywhere, all the time. And so that made it really interesting to me in that way, because this is a factor of life all over this region that becomes super visible in this one place, similarly, I originally was interested in Governor's Island because it's half artificial, but then I became much more interested in it because of this history of its use as a military base for so many years. In terms of process, it really is a process of collection. So it's a process of accumulating materials, and they can be in a lot of different forms. I usually explore things through a lens first. So I accumulate images, and I accumulate sound, texts, and ideas, and interviews, and all kinds of different materials, and then I figure out what to do with them. And sometimes I do more than one thing with them. that's basically how the process works.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
Does it cost like the building average, and how much time it takes to be done with it?
A film costs as much money as you raise for it. That's basically how much money a film costs. That's always true, always the truth. Film budgets can expand almost infinitely, but in the art world we generally have very little money to make things, so we make things for a tiny fraction. We make films for a tiny fraction of what people make them for in the film world, and people from the film world are always shocked to find out, you made a 30-minute film for $8,000? How did you do that? And I was like, nobody got paid, that's how we did it. Nobody has union memberships in the art world. That's how it happens. Like, in the film world, you have to pay everyone union rates, so, you know, it's a totally different scene. Yeah, it's one of the really bad things about the art world, actually, is that people don't get paid properly. So in an ideal world where you can pay everyone what they should be being paid, you know, should have a budget of at least $10,000 to make a film. But it depends on what kind of film it is, it depends if it's a documentary, it depends if it's a fiction film, it depends how many people are working on it. It depends if you have actors or you don't have actors. It depends, you know, if you have to pay performers or not. It depends if you need to pay for your locations or not. It depends on all kinds of different factors. Basically, my advice to you is learn how to use Excel. And this is my advice to all artists as well as all filmmakers, is learn how to do spreadsheets. But seriously, budgets are a very powerful tool, not just for planning, but also for arguments with curators. And for funders, like to show funders that you know what you're doing and you can spend their money properly, and also that they actually need to give you more money than they've given you. You can make that argument much better with a line item budget than you can with just a vague list of things that you need. Right? So, yeah, budgeting. Really good thing to learn how to do.
What does your studio look like?
I have a lived workspace. So my studio is, according to my taxes, 18.5% of my house. and it's actually my, I have part of, I live in a kind of loft space, so part of it is my studio, and part of it is actually my art storage, and part of it is the index archive, and then I live in the rest of it. So it's probably more than 18.5%, but my accountant says that's as much as I can write off.
I'm, as somebody in literature, I'm so curious about your complete degree, and I wonder, and also the presence of HD in one of your pieces, so I did wonder about whether a kind of European modernism at all informs your thinking about kind of speculative histories, and I think I've mentioned before, I wondered about Benjamin in A Brief History of Collapses.
Yeah, I mean, Benjamin's writing on history is very important to me. Especially his writing on like a materialist historical practice, and the idea that I've actually used this in my own writing, his notion that you have to is it the task of the historian is to seize hold of the past as it flashes into the present at a moment of danger, and that's what your job is as a historian. I think it's a really beautiful description of like what a historian is meant to do. Because it's not that, you know, it doesn't assume that the past is fixed. It's not a fixed thing. The past is something that, you know, is what we need it to be in the present. Okay. Yeah. And obviously, like, modernism as a literary movement has also been very influential for my writing. So, yeah, stream of consciousness stuff. Yeah.
Have you received a lot of like pushback on any of your artwork?
No. We occasionally have some things with the index, with like specific projects. But the only time we've gotten like an actual complaint with the Index of the Disappeared is when we deviated from our usual practice. Our usual practice is to only use documents that have been officially declassified or are in the public domain. And when the Snowden leaks happened, we actually made an exception for the documents from the Snowden leaks that had been vetted by newspapers, so that any information in them that would damage like active intelligence sources or would be damaging to, you know, people who were feeding intelligence to CIA officers, for example, and, you know, so on and so forth, all of that had been removed. So we did make an exception for those documents, and that's the one time we actually got a complaint about an index installation, because somebody who I believe worked in Navy intelligence complained about a window piece that we had done based on one of those documents. He was like, this is still officially classified. You can't use it as a basis for an artwork. And we were like, it was published in the Washington Post. You know, it doesn't matter, it's still officially classified, which is technically true. And I was like, that's interesting, we should probably take legal advice about that. Because there are cases where people have been prosecuted for having like WikiLeaks cables on their personal computers, which is one of the reasons why we never used leaked documents in the archive, because it actually does expose you legally. And also because I think the WikiLeaks cables, for example, a lot of that stuff was extremely irresponsible in the way that it was released. With absolutely no vetting, no protection for anybody. I know a number of Afghans who actually immediately became Taliban targets on the release of these documents. So, you know, it was really quite irresponsibly done the way they did it. Yeah.
You talked in one of our classes about security measures when you're back home and your families.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just wondering, does our government
I don't officially know, but I kind of assume so, yes. Because according to the current law, for or surveillance, you only have to be one hop away from someone who's not a U.S. citizen. My father renounced his U.S. citizenship, therefore they are completely within their rights to collect anything they want from me. Also from anyone who talks to me, so just fair warning. You're all, because there's a two-hop law, so, you know, anyone who's two hops away from a non-U.S. citizen who is a legitimate target of surveillance can also be legitimately surveilled without a warrant. This is for warrantless surveillance. Like, you know, a FISA warrant gets you anybody you want in the entire United States. But this is for warrantless surveillance. They can, yeah, they can listen to anything I do at any time, which I just kind of assume they're doing, and also to anyone who talks to me at any time, who has ever called me on the phone, Gary, who has ever sent me an email. Any of you are just one hop away from me, so you are also now on the list. If the NSA ever wants to listen to you without a warrant, they totally can. Yeah. Congratulations. Yeah.
Good question.
Anyone else?
We're all afraid to ask.
Now you're all afraid to ask. I basically just live my life very openly and say, you know, I have nothing to hide. I really don't. We just have running family jokes about it. Yeah.